B'shem Hashem na'aseh v'natzliach, Shiur Torah, Bukhim Abayim. We're back here on our Tuesday night Shiur of the new series, now about a month old, the IGGERET HAGRA series about the letter that the Gaomi Vilna, the genius from Vilna, Rabbi Eliyahu wrote and to his family, and Bezat Hashem, tonight's shiur will be for a refuah shlema for Rabbanit Levana Bat Sarah, Rav Ephraim Ben Shulamit, Rabbanit Sarah Bat Anat, David Ben Esriah, Doris Bat Jorah, Joshua Ben Noach, Alex Ben Noach, Yitro Ben Avraham, Talia Bat Sarah, Orit Bat Ilana, and also for a Atzlacha Rabba for Yitro Ben Avraham, Oshri Ben Doris, Gabi Ben Doris, Elad Ben Doris, David Ben Esriah, Netanel Yosef Ben Noach, Marsha Bat Juli, Ayla Bat Marsha, Samuel Ben Marsha, Sefash Ben Marsha, Alexander Ben Marsha, Shaul Ben Farzane, and also Zera Shelikema for Mazal Bat Brucho Bela. Oh, and also Atzlacha Rabba for Reuven Chaim Ben Pala Paren. Kadosh Baruch Hu Yivarech Otam. And all of the wonderful donors, supporters, and people that are learning our shiurim from all over the world, Baruch Hashem. So we have our letter from the Gaon Mivilna that each week develops further and further. We can see what the Chachamim wrote in the Gemara. They said that even the mundane conversation between the sages must be studied. Needless to say, we see it here in a letter that the Gaon wrote to his family, and that's why you'll see in practically every Jewish library and every scholar's house, you're always going to see at least one or more books that are compiled of different letters that the Chachamim have written their family or different people in their life. A lot of things are learned from the letters of the sages. And here we see that the what would typically be considered simply a letter of instructions that someone has given his family, we see how much Torah we can learn from it when it's coming from a genius, when it's coming from a sage of the Jewish people. Now, over the last few weeks, the Gaon Mivilna has told us how terrible it is to not only waste our words, but to misuse our words, to say Lashon Hara, to say things that Motzi Shemra, which is even worse in some aspects, where you're making up rumors about people, which of course people like to make up rumors, people like to say different things, and to say all types of things that are simply fake in order to make themselves look better or make somebody else look worse. Now, the key here is that there is an enormous amount of punishment for that, and the Gaon Mivilna says that even for wasted words and idle conversations, a person could be going to Kafakela, which, again, I haven't forgotten my promise to you guys to do a shiur about Kafakela. Be'ezrat Hashem, this too will come at some point in the future, and perhaps maybe even during the series. But as far as the wasted words, we see that this is a horrendous thing. But now he moves on to the next thing, the next set of instructions that he's telling his family, that he's telling his wife, that he's telling his mother, that he's telling all of the people of his house. These instructions, and he's of course telling us all of these different things. And now he moves on into a different subjects, because after telling her that she should not let her mouth cause her flesh to sin, and make sure that you don't become an item in the world that causes Hashem anger. Now he goes on into a very deep issue that is, practically a standard issue of a standard topic in Judaism throughout all of the generations, but has become, unfortunately, much more controversial in today's world simply because people don't understand what it means to be a Jew, what it means to be a woman, what it means to have honor. You know, most people think that to have honor means to have more likes on Facebook and on Twitter. You know, you have more followers, you have more people liking your picture of immodesty. They figure that if they invite you to be a some type of speaker at an event, that's giving you honor. If they give you a certain role at a company, that's giving you honor. And there's really nothing further from the truth. Nothing further from the truth, you know, when it comes to honor. Unfortunately today, the Satan has convinced people that he is the best teacher. And thereby he's teaching them that they need to do everything the opposite of what Hashem said. And in essence, has trained enough people to create many messengers to teach people how to do the exact opposite of what they're supposed to do, literally teaching people how to be stupid. And it's not just a spiritually stupid, but morally stupid. Like this one thing that someone you know, sent me. I mean, of course, I like to get these things so I know what's going on in the world, since Baruch Hashem, I don't watch the news or read the news or anything. So from time to time, people send me different things. And unfortunately, many times these things make me very sad, just because I see how much trouble we're in, not just as a Jewish people, but as mankind. When you see that in the news, there is currently a case between a husband suing his wife because the wife is insisting on turning their little boy, their 5 or 6 year old boy, into a girl. And she's giving him hormones, and the school is supporting her, giving him hormones to become a girl. And the courts are, in essence, supporting her of making this boy into a girl. And unfortunately, society is encouraging this stupid woman to make a young boy into a girl. And her rationale behind it is that he liked some sparkly bag that was a girl's bag at some point, and he chose to play with a toy that usually girls play with. And from that moment on, when he was 3 years old or 4 years old, she decided, no, he's really a girl inside a boy's body. So unfortunately, it's a very sad scenario. I mean, of course, you know, whether Jew or Gentile, we wish this boy well, and we even wish his mother well, even though she, I'm not really sure there's a recovery from such psychoticness. And I feel horrible for the father, too, to have to deal with such a thing. But nonetheless, this is a product of society today. This is a product of society that does not want to listen to Hashem, does not want instructions from a divine being, does not want the instructions that we got at Mount Sinai, that really had everything work pretty well, as long as we followed it. You know, for all of those people that hate the Torah and say that the religion has caused all of the wars in the world and so on, no, it's completely wrong. It's actually desecrating the Torah that has caused all the wars and all the problems. Anytime we followed the Torah, there was peace in the world, especially during the time of Shlomo HaMelech. There was not a single war, not a single war at the time of Shlomo HaMelech. People were wealthy, people were successful, people were healthy. And unfortunately, when people don't listen to the Torah, we see it throughout history, society simply gets destroyed. And it's both in the Jewish world and non-Jewish world. So a lot of times you see that there are issues in the world, but every time you see that in the Jewish world, it always makes you cringe a little bit. When you see that it's in the frum world, in the religious world, meaning the best of them, the ones that are in essence, you know, saying that they're following the Torah, and you see that these very same issues that are happening in a secular world, in a non-Jewish world, are happening in a frum world, then you see that, you know, we're in trouble, and perhaps you start crying, realizing that you live in such a generation. And unfortunately today, there are many women that have decided to take on the idol worshiping religion of feminism, and in the name of God, though, you know, they're worshiping the Baal, but at the same time saying that they're also worshiping God at the same time. So they're feminist. They want to have women power. They want to, you know, have more rights, more position, while being, you know, religious, at least in their opinion. So you'll see all, these women, generally speaking, are very immodest, but they claim to be modest. How do they claim to be modest? They say, listen, I'm covering my body. Yeah, but covering your body with another layer of skin because your clothes are so tight is not exactly qualify as modest. Covering your head with a wig that's longer than the exile is not exactly modest. No, we're going to define modesty. No one's going to tell me what modesty is. I'm going to decide. And if the men have problems, let them not look. And this is obviously showing that these people are, on one end, they're victims of the Satan himself. They're victims of the Satan himself. And number two, sometimes some of these types of women that are very aggressive about their immodesty and immorality, simply said, there's no recovery for such a person in most cases without divine intervention. Because a person like this does not want to hear the truth. And Rabbi Yisrael Misalant says that in his Sefer Nativei Or, that when a person gets a rebuke, when he sees the truth and he rejects it, he is at that moment, at that very second, signing off her own deen, her own judgment in Shemaim, that Hashem has to get involved in her life personally. And Hashem doesn't get involved by tiptoeing around the political correctness of the world with speech. When Hashem gets involved, Hashem Yachem. That's what I can tell you. So here, the Gaon Mivilna is going to tell his wife, i.e. us, what it means to have honor. What does it mean for a Bat Israel to have honor? What does it mean to have respect? What are the benefits of it? What is the downside of it? And also, what are some of the things that perhaps, the Yetzirah uses as a tool to entice you otherwise? And he says the following. Al-Ken kol kvoda bat melech pnima. The Gaon Mivilna quotes a verse from Psalms, from Tehillim, chapter 45, verse number 14. He said, since the honor of the king's daughter is when she dwells inside, kol asher tzarich lach, tikhi akol al yedei shaliach. Therefore, purchase all of your needs through an emissary. Ve'af imu pa'amayim ve'shalosh biyoker, even if it would cost two or three times more expensive, Ayad Hashem Tikzar. He brings another verse from Bamidbar, Book of Numbers, chapter 11, verse 23. Is there a limit to what Hashem can provide? So here, the Gaon Mivilna is giving his wife very clear instructions that first and foremost, we need to understand, what does kavod, what does the honor of the woman mean? What is the honor of a woman? Is the honor of a woman all of these things that we mentioned before? A position, a job, a bank account, a certain type of husband? What is the honor of a woman? And number two, since we know what the honor is, this means you'll have to become a bigger spender, but different ways. And if you're worried about money, don't worry about money. Hashem has no limitations to what he can give. Hashem Yitbarach zan mikarnei re'emim ad betzekinim. For Hashem Yitbarach, Hashem the may be blessed, feeds all creatures from the tall horned re'em, which is the huge animal that lived at that time, that is bigger even than any dinosaur Hollywood wants to put up on a screen. This huge re'em that lived even at the time of Noach. Noach actually took two re'em, and they were so big still as babies that they had to follow the teva of Noach. The ark of Noach couldn't fit them, so these two things would follow it, and Hashem miraculously made the water that wherever the teva went, the water would cool off, because everywhere else it was boiling enough to the point of melting anything else that was there. But wherever these re'emim were, they and the teva were, they were in good water. As far as defeating them, he made a hole, well, I guess for their size, made a hole in the teva to feed them through that hole. Now, of course, the whole thing is miraculous. How many animals fit? How would the food in the teva fit to feed such big animals that were on the outside? So, of course, everything was miraculous. But again, when Hashem makes miracles, He likes to make certain miracles with a certain workings of nature that He created. So, where He could say, okay, listen, a person needs to eat. So I'm not going to tell you don't eat the whole year. But you can eat one piece of food, like the angel gave Eliyahu HaNavi. He gave one piece of food in the desert, and Eliyahu HaNavi was able to have superhuman powers to traveling from where he was all the way to Mount Sinai in a full speed running that's beyond any comprehension that we have. So of course, again, running through the desert and doing things like that, this requires a lot of energy and beyond just what a piece of meat is going to give you. So, but Hashem uses nature that He created, the teva that He created, which in Hebrew called ateva means the nature, which has those letters have the gematria, have the numerical value of 86, which is the same number as the numerical value of the name of Hashem. And here we see that Hashem hides Himself within nature. So here the Gaon Vilna says that we know that if you're worried about money, don't have to worry about money. Why? Because Hashem Yitbarach feeds all creatures from the tall horned re'em to the lowly lice. Little lice that kids get. I remember in my day many, many decades ago, we were in kindergarten. Once in a while, the teacher would have to check the kids for lice in kindergarten. Check the kids for lice. The parents would check the kids for lice. I'm not sure if that's the same still today in kindergartens. I doubt it. But nonetheless, that's how it was. Lice was very common back then. And, so he says, this little tiny lice that you could barely see with the naked eye, Hashem brings it parnasa also, gives it food also, this lice. Well, what do you think? This lice has a job on Wall Street? You think this lice has to go and beg the giraffe for some foods? No, Hashem provides the lice food. Just like He provides the lice food, He provides the ram food, He provides adequately for each and every one. What is lacking? So here we see that there are two major issues that we can talk from here until next year about. One is the issues of modesty and really the honor of a woman. And the second thing is the issue of parnasa. And that's what Bezat Hashem we're going to try to cover today. So first and foremost, here we see that the Gaon Mivilna brings a verse and from Psalms saying that the honor of the king's daughter is when she dwells inside. Here we see that the Gaon Mivilna is telling us that if you want to be an honorable woman, you have to be reserved. If you want to be with your picture on the internet, on Facebook, on Twitter, on PikTok and TikTok and Instagram and this gram and all types of WhatsApps and so on, you want your picture everywhere, even if your picture is modest. But you want your picture everywhere, you're not a reserved person. The more reserved, the less people are going to see you. Now, of course, in today's society, they're going to say, oh, that's chauvinism, that's sexism, that's this-ism and that-ism. Fine, you can call it whatever you want. The Gaon Mivilna, which was much smarter than any of us, says, no, our holy Torah says, in the name of David HaMelech, says the opposite. Says the opposite. Anyone that believes in the Torah has to understand David HaMelech, surely he's smarter than you. And David HaMelech says, no, the honor of the girl, the honor of the young woman, the honor of the older women. It's not a matter of beauty. It's not a matter of age, not a matter of anything else. But the honor of a woman is that she's reserved. Reserved meaning she's not in the public eye on a regular basis. Hence the reason why a woman in Judaism is not allowed to be a witness. She's not allowed to be a witness because it's not kavod for the woman to be interrogated and publicly embarrassed as it's commonly happens in lawsuits when there's interrogations and you're asking the witness and you're making them nervous and so on and so forth. You're never going to see a Jewish woman in a Jewish court as a witness. Also, there are certain roles that are not appropriate for a woman. And one of the main things that Rav Steinemann, Alav Shalom, used to fight tooth and nail. Used to fight tooth and nail, which is against the draft of women in the IDF. And this is not something that he created, because this also was at the time of the Chazon Ish. And in fact, when they came to the Chazon Ish, the Gdol Ador, and I said, Kvod Rav, listen, there are two major issues right now with the IDF, the Israeli Defense Force, Israeli Army. They're trying, these politicians, these Zionists, Yimach Shimam v'Zichram, that are trying to uproot the Torah. What are they trying to do? They're trying to force all of the Bachurim in the yeshiva to join the army, leave the yeshiva, shave their heads, and go to the army. That's it. Forget the yeshiva, forget the books, forget Hashem, forget everything, Chas v'Shalom. Leave the yeshiva, go to the army. Even though the Torah says, Im lo briti yomam v'layla, chukot shamayim v'aretz lo samti, that if not for my covenant day and night, the rules of the world will cease to exist, that if there's nobody in the world learning Torah even for a single second, HaKadosh Baruch Hu will simply destroy the world. And even though it also says that HaKadosh Baruch Hu told Moshe Rabbeinu, go to war. And Moshe Rabbeinu, what did he do? He had 1,000 men studying Torah and 1,000 men with spears and swords. How are the people with the Gemara, Rashi, Tosfot, Chumash, how are they going to help the people going to war? What, are they going to hit people with the book? No. They're learning Torah and they're fighting with the swords. Yeah, but how? Why don't you get the guys with the Torah, with the books, with the scrolls at the time to go join and pick up a sword themselves? Why are they being lazy? Not lazy. They're the reason why we're going to win the war. The guys with the books, the guys learning Torah, they are the reason why we're going to go. We're going to win the war. But since HaKadosh Baruch Hu told us that we have to work within nature, and we cannot live on a miracle, we can't just say, listen, we are not, you know, Hashem said go to war, so we're just going to open the books. We have to open the books regardless. He's saying we have to go to war. That's a milchemet mitzvah. It's a war that's a mitzvah itself. We have to show our effort. We pick up a sword. Who's picking up a sword? People that are warriors, people that are trying to kill people for fun, like the Romans and the Greeks and all of the Nazis. No, these are other Avrichim. They're just not on the same level. They're not on the same level. They're not people that are toiling in Torah nonstop. They're people that are a little lesser level. They're going to go and fight. They're going to pick up a sword. And HaKadosh Baruch Hu is going to make that sword kill 1,000 people. Without the guy doing too much. Why? He doesn't need to train for war. He's just the effort to make it look normal, to make it look natural. So we see here that the times we won all of the wars was because the people of learning Torah, following mitzvot. So you're telling me that I should take all of the people that are learning Torah and put them in the army? That's against the Torah. But of course, the Zionists don't care about the Torah. They hate the Torah. And even the people that promote Zionism, but in the name of religion, like we see this Arur Merusha Bennett, he claimed to be religious all these years with his kippah on the back of his head. Even the reforms don't put a kippah on the back of the head. But he's so embarrassed of his kippah that he put it in the back of the head. So that's why in all of the pictures you're ever going to see of this wicked person, which I don't recommend to look at it, because the Gemara says you're not allowed to look at the face of a rasha. But nonetheless, not everybody's so sensitive spiritually. Anyone that sees the picture or video of this Arur Rasha Bennett, you're never going to see a kippah. It's not that he's not wearing a kippah. He's wearing a kippah, but he's wearing it in the back of his head. In the back of his head. But yet he claims to be the representative of Judaism, representative of Torah, and so on and so forth. How are you representing the Torah if you're going to go join the people that are anti-Torah? The lefty, liberal, anti-Torah, Lapid, and the rest of the Shaim. But this is what happens, Rabotai. When people tell you one thing and they do something else, HaKadosh Baruch Hu says, see, he was always that way. It's not that he changed. He was always that way. That's why even Rabbi Ovadia spoke against him when he was still in this world. Nonetheless, you see that sometimes people are going to say things about the people that are learning Torah. Say they should go and fighting the army. Now, of course, if somebody is just filling up a spot in the yeshiva and smoking cigarettes all day and not really learning, yes, they should go to the army. They should go to the army. Instead of getting in trouble, instead of wasting time, they should go to the army. And that's what Moshe Rabbeinu did. People that were not really 100% into the books, they should go to the army and fight the war. But if somebody is seriously learning nonstop and he's seriously dedicating themselves, they don't necessarily need to be the biggest scholar in the world, the biggest genius in the world. Even if they're an average level or even below average level of intellect, but they are toiling in Torah, you leave them learning Torah. You leave them learning Torah. So at the time of the Chazon Ish, the people came to him and said, listen, these Zionists want to uproot all of these Bachurei Yeshiva. We have to fight it. You're right, we have to fight it. You have to do protests, you have to send letters, you have to do everything you can. Yeah, but Kvod HaRav, now these Arurim, these cursed Zionists, also want to do something else. What do they want to do? They want to force the girls to go into the army. They want to first force all of the Bnot Israel, all of the daughters of Am Israel, to go and join the army. So we can't fight both of them. Meaning, sure we can, but if we're spreading our powers in these two places, we're going to end up losing both. As the Gemara says, tafasta merubetz lo tafasta. That sometimes it's you have to make sure that you capture the bird in hand rather than worrying about the two in the bush. So here we see that this is a very big dilemma. On one end, you're saying they're trying to uproot all of the Bachurim from going to yeshiva and going to the army. On another end, you're saying that there's all these girls, all of these tzadikot, Bnot Israel, they're saying they're going to fight tooth and nail to force all of them to join the army. What no army in the world does, they want to do. No army in the world forces their women to go into the army. No country in the world forces their girls to go into the army, but the Zionist Israeli army, they're going to force their girls to go into the army. One of the most ludicrous thing in history. And the reality is, in most places, in many countries, they don't even have women in their army that even have the capacity that they give some women today in the Israeli army. But nonetheless, they want them to fight. They want them to fight just like the men. So, Chazon Ish has a big halachic question. Which one do we fight? Both are important. On one end, you have all of the Bachurim learning Torah. On another end, you have all of the daughters of Israel. They're going to go to the army. Hashem Yishmo, what's going to happen? We see what happens now. Even though the draft is not forced for women today, we see many women in Eretz Yisrael join the army, and some stupid people send their daughters from America and other countries to Eretz Yisrael so they could go to the army. It's one of the dumbest things in the history of mankind, but unfortunately, many people that want to show as if they're supporting Israel, they send their daughters, not their sons, their daughters to the Israeli army. They have no idea that they just literally just put their daughter into hot lava and there's no return. Why? Because the army is not a place for women. It's not a place for women. The amount of rape and abortions that happens in the army is something out of this world. And there's nothing that anyone can do about it practically. It's simply nothing that anyone can do about it. The amount of abortions they have in the army is unprecedented. The amount of rape that happens in the army, unprecedented. And there's nothing anyone can do about it. And virtually no one even talks about this nightmare. So to have all of these young girls go to the army, disaster. Chazon Ish says, listen, even though we have to fight for our boys to stay in yeshiva, if one of them or two of them or some of them or all of them go to the yeshiva, it's not the end of the world. Go to the army, it's not the end of the world as far as that, because we're always going to have some stay behind. We're always going to find certain ways. And this is something that is not necessarily one of the cardinal sins. But if our girls go to the army, that is areg ve'al yavo. That is, it's better they die and they don't go to the army, because for sure it's going to be destroyed. And if the girls end up going to the army, for sure all of the boys are going to leave the Torah after them. Even if the boys end up staying, let's say we only fight for the boys to stay in yeshiva and we let the girls go to the army, all of those boys are going to end up following those girls. We end up losing both of them. So all of the effort, the Chazon Ish says, has to go in order to save the girls. All of the effort, all of the energy. This was obviously successful to a certain extent, and unfortunately it failed to a certain extent, where unfortunately you do see many women going to the Israeli Defense Force and unfortunately not coming back the same. Of course, nobody's really going to talk about it or even say anything about it, but it's znut, immorality, has become so standard in society today that it's as if people will just look at things like, oh, what's the big deal? What's the big deal that a little boy wants to be a girl? What's the big deal that she already married 15, 20, 30 men before she actually married her actual husband? What's the difference that this? What's the difference that he married 30 women before he married his real wife? What's the difference? People don't think it's a big deal. People think it's, oh, what? So they're having a good time. They're having a good time. And I remember even as a kid, I would, I would have certain people that I knew in the neighborhood, and they would leave, and I'd tell them, oh, where are you going? They go, I'm going to my girlfriend's house. I'm like, it's 1 o'clock in the morning. What do you mean going? No, I'm sleeping at my girlfriend's house. And I'm thinking to myself, even at that time, before religion, before everything, how does a normal parent allow their 15, 14-year-old daughter to have her boyfriend sleep over? I mean, how stupid can you be? How immoral can you be? How filthy can you be? What do you think they're doing? Playing Tetris all night? What do you think they're doing? And you know what? Some of the parents know what they're doing and simply have no problem with it. They don't have a problem that their 14-year-old has somebody that's going to use her like public property for X amount of time until who knows. You know, and everyone knows that's an adult that this relationship will not last. But they're still going to tell you, oh, they're so cute. Yeah, they're so cute. Yeah, they're so cute. And slowly, until he dumps her like bad food in 6 months from now or a year from now until he finds somebody else that's cuter. What are you? You have the delusion that you think that he's going to marry your daughter? He's just using her to fill his needs. But many parents allow this to happen in their homes. They allow the boys to stay at their house. They allow the girls to stay at their house. And this is literally becoming standard among society. I'm not sure how it is in Europe, but I know in America, it's standard. It's standard for parents to allow their child's boyfriend or girlfriend to sleep in their house and do all the things that married people do. Hashem Yishmo V'Yatzil. I always ask myself, how much mercy does Hashem have? How much mercy does Hashem have that literally, just on an act like this, he should destroy the world according to the Torah? Just on an act like this, not destroy the people, destroy the whole world just on an act like this. He destroyed the entire Beit HaMikdash on similar things like this. So here we see how much mercy HaKadosh Baruch Hu has. But nonetheless, the Gaon Mivilna brings us a verse. And we have to delve further. Because after bringing us David HaMelech, where did David HaMelech get the notion that the honor of a woman is when she's inside? That her being reserved, being honorable as far as not being someone that is out in the public, yapping out there and telling everybody, oh, you want to go to shoe store? Oh, you need to get shoes? No problem. You're allowed to go get shoes. No problem. You're allowed to go get a bag. You're allowed to go get lipstick. That's modest. You're allowed to go buy groceries. There's no problem of going outside. But there's no need to go for 5 hours to buy shoes. There's no need to go yench around the whole neighborhood for 9 hours just to go buy a dress. There's no need to go buy groceries for 6 hours. You know, no one needs that kind of time, because in reality, it's not taking you 6 hours to buy the stuff. It's not taking, you don't need to have all your girlfriends show up with you to go buy shoes or a bag. It's not necessary, but that's what they do. Why? Because that's what people do today. They figure that's the fun part of life. They have no idea what life is, but nonetheless, that's what they think life is. So where did David HaMelech get the notion that a woman should be reserved? Let's see, Rabotai. In our Torah, in the book of Isaiah, we see that Isaiah rebukes a group of women for walking around, waltzing around in their high heels and their perfume causing the people to give them attention, and not only regular people, but even the non-Jews. And he rebukes them in chapter 3. It's a whole section where the prophet tells the women a rebuke in the name of Hashem. In chapter 3, verse number 16, it says, Hashem said, because the daughters of Zion are haughty, walking with outstretched necks and winking eyes, walking with dainty steps, jingling with their feet. Therefore, the Lord will afflict the heads of the daughters of Zion with lesions, and Hashem will bear their private parts. On that day, the Lord will remove the splendor of the shoe bells and headscarves, the moon-shaped ornaments, the necklaces, the bracelets, the veils, the bonnets, the leg bands, the hair ties, the brujais, the earrings, the rings, the nose rings, the robes, the shawls, the kerchiefs, pouches, the mirrors, the linens, the turbans, the clasps. What is this, an infomercial for all these different... What's going on? Why is he mentioning all these different tools? All these different things that women use? What is this, a Walmart? Why are you mentioning all these things in the Torah? This is a Tanakh. It's not a catalog for clothes. Why is he mentioning this? They're going to get a punishment for each and every single one of them. Not because each and one of them is forbidden, but because what they did was forbidden, and they used the things that were permissible in a forbidden way. And they'll get a separate punishment for each one of these things. And it will be that in the place of fragrance, there will be rot. All the places she put fragrance in areas like the neck and areas like you could figure out on your own, the rot will come out. Maggots. In the place of a belt, abrasion. In the place of coiffure, baldness. In the place of ornament belt, a belt of sackcloth. A burn in the place of beauty. Your men will fall by the sword, and your might in war. Her doorways will mourn and lament. She will be wiped out. She will sit on the ground. Here we see a clear rebuke for Bnot Israel, not the Goyot, the women of Israel, for walking around immodestly. As I said, book of Isaiah, chapter 3, verse number 18. So here we see another place in the Torah showing that David HaMelech is not the only one that's talking about that the honor of a woman is inside, and if she wants to be dishonorable, she doesn't want to be the daughter of a king. There's a consequence for it. But is there even more places? Yes. Where? Five books of Moses. What's better than the five books of Moses? Nothing. Book of Deuteronomy, chapter 23. HaKadosh Baruch Hu tells us a clear commandment, clear instructions how to behave. In chapter 23, verse 15. So that he will not see a shameful thing among you and turn away from behind you. How does this have to do with modesty? Chachamim say, what is ervat davar? That Hashem should not see the ervat davar and then run away from you. What is ervat davar? Erva is a name for the private part. In biblical language, Hashem doesn't talk like us. He doesn't have street language. Hashem talks in a respectable way. Hashem talks in a holy way. So Hashem doesn't use the filthy words that we use. He doesn't have, there isn't a filthy word for the private part. Irva is considered that. Anything of nakedness. Anything that's in essence supposed to be covered, it's called irva. So he says, anything of you that is irva, that is nakedness, and he's not talking about just the private part. Anything. The stomach, the shoulders, the neckline, the thighs, so on and so forth. All of those things. Those things show anything that is supposed to be covered is not covered. Hashem runs away. Simple. The end. What does it mean when Hashem runs away? That Hashem walks away from a person. What does it mean that Hashem walks away from a person? Simple. Chachamim say that HaKadosh Baruch Hu doesn't have to get off of his throne in order to punish. Simply, as he says in the five books of Moses, he simply turns a blind eye. No more protection. He walks away. Once the protection is gone, once he is no longer in the room, all of the haters of the Jewish people have free access to do whatever they wish. Hashem Yishmol V'Yatzil. Meaning he doesn't have to actually outright punish a person. But as soon as the protection is gone, the nature of the world takes over. The nature of the world is, number one, you have one rule. Esav Soneh Yaakov. Nazis. Haman. Anti-Semitism is standard. It's normal behavior. It's not abnormal to be anti-Semitic. It's actually normal to be anti-Semitic. People try to figure out, oh, I don't know why people hate Jews. What do you mean you don't know? You read the Torah once in your life? There's an halacha. It's not like a saying or a story. It's an halacha. Actual halacha. Esav soneh liyakov. Esav hates Yaakov. It's a rule in nature no different than gravity. Now, it's not always practiced. It's not always practiced. And not all of the people that are non-Jews hate the Jews. Some of them are lovers of the Jews in the Torah, and they're called the righteous among the people. But nonetheless, there is a rule in the world that there is a certain amount of people, quite frankly, the majority of people, are haters of the Jewish people. Simple. That's just the way it is. Now, just like there's different types of gases in the world, you have the oxygen, hydrogen, and so on. Guess what? There's different types of people. Some of them are like oxygen for the Jewish people, where they help them and they protect them and they support them. Those are the righteous Noahides. And some of them are outright poison. You know, Cyclone B, the gas that killed a bunch of millions of Jews in Nazi Germany. That's the anti-Semitism in the world. That's a reality. That's a rule in the world. It's not some new thing that came up 75 years ago. It's a rule in the world that HaKadosh Baruch Hu has. And as soon as the protection is gone, you are now walking into a room full of Cyclone B. You may survive. Some people actually survive. Miraculous stories. You may survive. Most likely you won't, because You're playing with fire here. But hey, go ahead. You don't want Hashem's protection? Be my guest. And you see, all of the people that care less about Hashem, that walk around immodest, that live immodest life, eventually they all die like dogs and with a lot of regrets. Unfortunately, that's just the reality in the world. When people listen to Hashem, they have Hashem's blessing, they have Hashem's protection. Now, aside from that, nature also has other things. Esav is not the only enemy. You also have nature itself. You have cancer. You have other types of diseases. You have all types of crises. You have all types of problems in the world. When a person does not have Hashem in their life, when she cares less about Hashem protecting her, about Hashem being next to her at all times, she doesn't care about it. Hashem says, you don't care, no problem, I'll leave. But that means other people have to take over. Other things have to take over. Other problems have to take over. Why? Because I was protecting you from all those. I was protecting you from all those. I was taking all the heat for you. You don't want me here because you want to walk around like some zonah? No problem. Be my guest. You have free choice. It's not really free, but you think it's free. There's a concept. There's a cost for it. You're just going to find out in a little while. And unfortunately, Rabotai Karim, that's what you see time and time again. What do you think? The people that are feminist in the name of Judaism now, you know, these so-called women that are call themselves religious, but they're feminist. You think that their lives are going to be a walk in the park? You think that their lives are going to be any good? You see, if you have the ability, you follow the lives of each and every single one of them, and you will see tragedy run after them. Tragedy run after them, one after another, with no exception. Why? They're desecrating the Torah, and they're doing exactly the opposite of what Hashem says. Hashem said, "Kol kvoda bat melech pnima." The honor of a woman is to be reserved. It's inside. You're doing the exact opposite, but you're using Hashem's name.
Now I told you already that if you're going to act this way, I'm going to run away from you. I'm going to run away from you. You have no protection. And people simply do not take the Torah seriously. They don't take Hashem seriously. He took himself seriously when he wrote the Torah, but they don't take him seriously. And they think that anyone that says simply what Hashem said is fanatic, is crazy, is this, is that. But then they're surprised that tragedy follows them. They're surprised that tragedy follows them. And unfortunately today, Rabotai Yekelim, it's no big mystery. It's no big mystery, but it's a statistical fact. It's a statistical fact that the number one cancer killing people in society is the cancer of the private parts of the men and women. Number one cancer that's killing people, that there's nothing that can be done about it. Hashem is not helping a lot of people that have this cancer, so much so that as soon as certain guys have prostate cancer, people pretty much just start saying their goodbye. They found out the guy has prostate cancer, unless it's really early, most people are starting to say goodbye for this person. Nah, stop working, enjoy the last little bit that you have in the world. Same thing with women. Soon as a woman has cancer, that's it. Rabotai, this is what's happening in the world. Of course, you're going to say, yeah, but somebody had cancer and they recovered. Yeah, they recovered, but are they the same? They recovered, but could you have lived without it? They recovered, but how many didn't? Have you noticed that the cancer in the world is most pertinent in the sex organs? I mean, you all think it's something that's no big deal. It was never like that before. So you can't say, oh, it's the food. If it was the food, then the stomach cancer would kill a lot of people. If you say, oh, it's phones, then brain cancer would kill most people. But it's not. It's the cancer of sex organs. There's a reason for it. HaKadosh Baruch Hu says, listen, you want to behave the way you want. You want to be immoral, commit adultery, commit all types of immorality before marriage, during marriage, or simply look like you do. Look like you do. Look like a harlot. Look like a playboy. Look like a guy that wants to have 15 wives, like some sheikh. You want to look like that? You want to act like that? No problem. I'm leaving, Hashem says. And when he leaves, problems show up. And this, Rabotai, is the most politically incorrect honesty you will ever hear. Because that's the facts. Now here, the Gaon Mivilna is telling the same thing. To who? To who is he telling to? To some putza? To some girl that walks around with a tank top? Who is he telling to? He's telling this to his tzaddikah wife and his mother. That's who he's telling this to. He's telling this to his family, to his kids, his daughters. He's not telling it to some putza. Why? Why? Because as long as I was home, perhaps people had some yetzerah show up, but they were too embarrassed to do it next to me. They were too embarrassed next to do it next to the Abba. They were too embarrassed next to do it next to the Gaon. They were too embarrassed to do it next to the big rabbi. I'm not going to be home. But Hashem's still here. Hashem's still here, and you have to be careful. You have to be careful. How careful do you have to be? How careful? Careful to the extent, Rabotai Yekarim, that even the things that you need, kol asher tzarich lach, tzarich means need, not you want. You don't want a third pair of shoes. No. Tzarich, like food. You need food. You can't live without food. Drink. You need those things. Those things that you need, don't go to the store. Don't go to the store. So I'm going to get it. I'm going to eat. I'm going to feed the kids. Send somebody. Yeah, it's expensive. It's not like today you have Amazon. If you buy $3 worth of goods, they send it to you for free. The shipping is $20, but the goods are $3. It's unbelievable. It's not like then. Or most stores, they have online stores. If you buy more than $50 or $100, shipping is free. Best, right? No. In those days, to have somebody go pick up your food, go pick up your stuff, bring it all to your house, would actually be more expensive than what you're buying. To the extent where he says, even if the cost of it would be 2 to 3 times more expensive, you had a budget of $100. Now you have to spend $300 or $400. $300 or $400 to buy $100 worth of goods. Why? To protect you from going outside of all of the filth that's out there. All of the men that are going to look at you. All of the women that want to talk lashon hara to you. All of the eyes that will look at you with their ayin hara and their motzi shemra and with their lashon hara. And all of the evil that's out there, there's no reason for you to be there. There's no reason for you. Not only there's no reason for you, but you should pay. You should pay not to go outside. How many women love to go outside? Oh, I'm a housewife. Oh, well, you're a housewife. You take care of your kids all day. No, they're in school. Oh, so you're a housewife. That's a good thing. But your kids are in school till when? What, 12? No, they're in school till 5. So what do you do all day? Oh, you know, I clean. Clean from the morning until 5 o'clock at night? What do you have, 500 rooms in your house? How much do you have to clean? No, 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 we just have a 3-bedroom. Ha ha, you're funny. Oh, so you're cleaning from what, 8 o'clock in the morning till 5 o'clock at night when the kids... No, no, just a little freshen up in the morning, maybe a half hour, hour maybe. Oh, okay, so you woke up, hopefully, you know, early enough to, you know, feed the kids or send them to school with food or something. You're not sleeping till 10 o'clock like some of these lazy people, right? Yeah, okay, so 8 o'clock, you got up, kids are off, you cleaned for an hour. It's 9. Last time I did a calculation, from 9 to 5, full-time job. What are you doing from that time? Oh, I cook. Ooh, what do you have, 30, 40 members in your house that you're cooking for 8 hours? No, stop being silly. I only cook for about a half hour or an hour. Okay, so we're 9, we got that. 10 now. Okay, so now we have 7 hours left. What do you do with 7 hours? What do you do with 7 hours? Oh, you know, I talk to my friends. I call my mother. I call this one. I go shopping. I go this. Oh, you're building yourself genom. You do nothing all day. Nothing all day. That's what you do. Only sins. You talk on the phone? For sure it's lashon hara. You talk with your girlfriend? For sure it's lashon hara. Have coffee with your girlfriends every day? For sure it's lashon hara and rechilut. What else are you going to talk about if it's not lashon hara and rechilut? Nothing else is interesting. What else are you going to talk about? So all day she's making sins. All day she's wasting time. And then she feels good because on the way to making sins, she'll perhaps listen to a shiur Torah. Hashem yishmor v'yatzil from such a life. Rabotai Karim, if you're with your kids all day, good. Be with your kids. It's better than even sending them to school. But if you're home doing nothing, for sure you're going to sin. For sure you're going to sin. Better off get a job of some kind. Do something. Work from the house. Not a job. Go to Wall Street. Do something. Do something in your house. Keep yourself busy. Don't go waltzing around with your girlfriends every single day and having coffee. Women always tell me, listen, ever since I became religious, you know, a lot of my friends are this and that. A lot of your friends. Who needs all these friends? Who needs all these people? What do you need all of these people for? You know, I want to have coffee. Everyday coffee? You don't have coffee in your house? Every day you have to go out to eat. You can't cook maybe a little omelet, a tuna sandwich in your house. Finished? You have to go out every single day. Some dinner. Your husband has to work 3 jobs just so you can eat lunch with your girlfriends. Hashem yishmo. What kind of life are you going to have? And then people are surprised why they get a divorce. They're surprised why adultery is running rampant, even in the best communities. Hashem yishmo. They're surprised. People are not occupying their time the right way. Literally, not occupying the time the right way. All day is being wasted on nothing. Nothing. Just doing nothing. This is a tragedy. Why? Misusing kol kvoda bat melech pnima is not the right way. No one is saying just sit there on your couch watching Oprah all day. No one is saying that, you know, don't go outside, but commit sins with your eyes all day. No one is saying that. No one is saying that you should sit there and do nothing all day and make sins with your mouth and with your eyes and Hashem Yishmo with what else. No one is saying that. You have to keep yourself busy. Keep yourself busy with mitzvot. Read some teilim. Do some chesed. If you're already going to leave the house, go to some hospice center. Visit some people that are dying, people that are sick. Do some chesed. Give some food out. Do something useful. Stop going out for coffee. The coffee shop should go out of business. Why? No Jewish woman should attend. A single one should attend to any of these places. There's nothing for you to do there other than sins. But what? No, it's my girlfriend. And that's the mentality of the feminist mentality. They want to go with the girlfriend. They want to go shopping together. They want to go eating together. They want a coffee together. And before you know it, she's more attracted to her friend than she is to her husband. Because when her friend calls her, she runs out of bed and she's excited to go do whatever her friend wants. When the husband comes from work, it's barely a hello. This is what's happening in society today. People are literally living an upside down life. Upside down life. And don't know what it means to be married. What it means to have honor. Now, there's an extraordinary amount of benefits of being modest, of being honorable. But most women simply don't learn this stuff because they learn the opposite. They learn early on that if you want to be attractive, that means less clothes. That means less clothes. The less clothes, the more attractive. That's why you'll see sometimes animals that got freed from the zoo walk around with perhaps barely any clothes, but yet they'll say hello to you like as if literally you'll see like the elephant leave the zoo somehow, escape somehow, and she's walking around as if hey. And you say to yourself, this person actually owns a mirror and thinks that they look good with no clothes. So it's not even a matter of like the only the ones that are fit. And no, it's literally the society has fooled people to the extent where they believe your looks are determined by the clothes, amount of clothes, not even type of clothes, amount of clothes. The tighter, the more attractive. The less, the more attractive. If you walk around naked, it's the best. And that's why, unfortunately, Rabotai, this poisonous teachings has infiltrated even the frum world. Well, you'll see some stupid parents dress their little daughters, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9-year-old daughters, with barely enough clothes to fit a baby. But they'll not only dress them with these shorts and these tank tops, you know, with the excuse, oh, she doesn't really look like a woman yet. Who cares? What do you mean, who cares? HaKadosh Baruch Hu cares. She's the daughter of HaKadosh Baruch Hu. You're dressing her with underwear. You're dressing her with clothes that's not even enough to take a shower in. That's how you dress your daughter. That's how you dress the daughter of HaKadosh Baruch Hu. And not only that, you see some of these dumb fathers who themselves sinned like no end before they got married. And everybody knows who they are. Everybody knows who they are. They sin to no end. And they know what it means when a woman is not modest. They take their little daughter that's barely wearing clothes for a baby, but she's 9 years old, to the synagogue. Yeah, sit next to me in the men's section, honey. And you say to yourself, Ribono shel Olam, how do you not destroy the world with such people? How do you not destroy the world when you have a 9, 10, 11-year-old girl, barely any clothes, a diaper covers more than that. But she's in the synagogue in the men's section. Why? She doesn't look like a woman yet. According to who? Every pedophile will think she looks like a woman. And the reality is, Rabotai, people are so oblivious to what HaKadosh Baruch Hu said in the Torah. They just walk around, waltz around with their motivational speakers being the goyim, being the media, being the news stations. That's where all this filth came from. This didn't come from Am Yisrael. This didn't come from Am Yisrael. But yet, Rabotai, people are confused to the extent where they think that this came from Am Yisrael. They think that all of this filth came from Am Yisrael. And it's absolutely not true, because we see that from the beginning, HaKadosh Baruch Hu hated immorality, hated immodesty, even when it was by accident. The Midrash in Parashat Vayishlach, Book of Genesis, in chapter 34, verse number 1, says, and Dinah, the daughter of Yaakov, was a little girl, She walked outside to go see what the girls were doing. Who are the girls? The non-Jewish girls. She walked outside to see what the girls were doing. And she's called Dina, the daughter of Leah. So the Midrash asks a very simple question. Why is Dina called the daughter of Leah? Why is she not called the daughter of what? She's not the daughter of Yaakov. She's the daughter of Yaakov also. She says, no. Dina went outside. She went out there just like her mother did. Our mother did it for the right reason, because she wanted to. She was at the door. Instead of being inside and waiting to see if Yaakov comes, she made an arrangement with Rachel that, no, he's going to come to me tonight in exchange for these flowers that you wanted and so on for my son Reuven. So I'm going to be, she was at the door. Like she took a step out of the door. That's already too much. Why? Your daughter saw that you are not so, you're not staying inside. You already went one step too much. Your daughter took 10 steps. And what happened to Dina, the daughter of Leah? Shem Yishmo. She didn't mean it on purpose. She wasn't walking around with the bathing suits. She wasn't walking around with a diaper like people. She wasn't walking around like that. She was walking a reserved tzaddikah. But unfortunately, Rabotai, even though she did, she already had her mind on something that she shouldn't have. What are the non-Jews doing? Hashem says, you want to know what the non-Jewish girls are doing? I'll show you. And he brought her, Hashem Yishmo V'yatzil. He brought her a punishment, Rabotai, that is one of the most painful things that happened in the Torah. Rabbi Yaron Reuven says he thinks the biggest tragedy that ever happened to the Jewish people happened in this parasha when Dina got raped by Shechem. Yimach Shemo v'zichro, this guy took this little girl and raped her. And then he thought, maybe I'll marry her too. Yimach Shemo. Until Reuven and Shimon killed him and the rest of his people. But the point being is, where did it all start with? She went outside to go see. She wanted to go see. Today, forget about the girl she wants to go see. The parents send them to go outside. Honey, go outside and play. Where am I going to play? I could stay home and maybe, I don't know, read Tehillim. Maybe I could do some mitzvot. Maybe I could go with you on a chesed trip to go do something good for society. What do you want me to do? No, go play somewhere. Go play. Come back before 10 o'clock. That's what they want. They want their daughters to go outside. Just get out of my hair. Nothing more tragic than that. Nothing. Parents have kids, but they don't want them. They have them, but they don't want them. Go somewhere. Go here. Go there. And if that's not bad enough, you have a bunch of parents that put their kids in a bunch of activities. Oh, she's going to play basketball. Oh, she's going to be a cheerleader. She's going to be this. All the things that are forbidden. Karet. You should call all of these after-school activities. Don't call them, why call it cheerleading and basketball? Why? Just call it karet. Will be eventually karet. Will be karet. That's what you call it. That's what's going to happen. But nobody pays attention. Why? They figure, no, my family is different. My daughter is different. My daughter is not going to come home with a big stomach one day at 14 years old. It's not going to happen. This, Rabotai, is what's happening in society. It's become standard. I remember when I was in junior high school, I was a little kid in junior high school. There was a bunch of, I went to public school. I didn't go to yeshiva. Public school, bunch of girls walking around with big stomachs, 13, 14-year-old girls walking around with big stomachs. They themselves are children. They're walking around with big 9-month-old babies in their belly, walking around like it's no thing. Standard, Rabotai. And today it's even standard to have abortions too. Murder is standard too. People are completely have lost any type of sensitivity to anything. We've become more animalistic than animals. Why? It all starts with completely disregarding the Torah and taking our own opinion and our own desires as a priority over the Torah itself. So now, the Sefer by Arav Shani, he was an extraordinary Mekubal about 100 or so years ago, maybe more even, his grandson, great-grandson, Arav Shani is one of the big Mekubalim in Eretz Yisrael. Very big chacham, very extraordinary person. So his grandfather wrote a very famous sefer that you're probably going to find in practically every library of a scholar. It's called Avat Chaim. This sefer simply has a bunch of true stories of things that happened to the Jewish people at different places, with eyewitnesses, with certain things. It's unbelievable because the stories in the sefer, even the most clever mind couldn't make them up. One of the stories, I've said it before, and every time I hear it or say it, I get scared all over again. A bunch of merchants are coming back from a trip, doing all types of things, and they're walking on, you know, to back to their town, and they're walking through the woods. And as they get closer and closer to the town, and they're in the woods, they see something they haven't seen before. They've been through the woods many times, they've gone in and out of town many times, but they notice that this time around, there's a house. There's a house in the woods. They've never seen this house before. So wonder who lives here. These guys, well-built, strong men, they're not thinking, they're in danger or anything of it. They figure, who's coming here? And they come towards the door. Right before they knock on the door, they noticed the window is crystal clear. And through the window, they could see a woman next to a huge barrel of boiling water. Boiling to the point where it's bubbling like lava. And right next to this huge barrel, there's a little girl. Perhaps 12 years old or so. And the girl is naked. And the mother takes her clothes, takes some type of dress or whatever it was, dips it in the boiling water, putting our hands, which extraordinary, you know, burning our own hands, inside this boiling water, screaming, then takes it out and puts the clothes on the girl. And the girl starts screaming and yelling. And the men could not handle what they just saw with their own eyes. They could not handle what their brain was calculating. What is happening here? This cannot be. This is not a normal thing. They got so scared. They ran back to the town, straight to their rabbi, who was one of the mekubalim of the day. And they said, "Rabbi, we saw such and such." And everybody heard what they said. So, well, let's go see. Let's go arrest this woman. Everybody started coming towards the house. The rabbi had ahead, because that's the way the chachamim are always ahead. And they're all getting into the place. They get to the same exact spot, but this time there's nothing. There's no young girl. There's no mother. There's no barrel. There's no house. It's all gone. Now, it wasn't one man. It was multiple men witnessed this, and they all said, "Listen, we're not crazy." And the rabbi said, "I know you're not crazy. And I also know that what you saw is 100% real. It's 100% real. And I intentionally brought all of you here to witness this. Because what these young men saw is what happens in Shamayim, as a heavenly judgment on a mother that dresses her daughter with immodest clothes. She and the daughter will be punished and are being punished right now. That mother used to live here," he says, "many years ago. And she used to dress her daughter in immodest clothes. And now HaKadosh Baruch Hu wanted us to see what he's doing to this woman that allowed her daughter to walk around immodestly, because she's the one that bought her the clothes. She's the one that made her clothes. So the daughter was pretty. So now they're both suffering. And you got a glimpse of the kafakela that they're in." This, Rabotai, the more you know and learn about this topic, the scarier it is. Because you realize how, number one, it's real. But number two, it's not even 1% of the full pie of what's really there when you go against Hashem. Parents that buy clothes for their kids that are immodest will have to pay a very heavy price. Parents that send their children to public school will have to pay a very heavy price. Parents that allow their children to be promiscuous knowingly, without rebuking them, without saying anything to them, and even helping them sometimes, telling them that he should have a girlfriend or two, will have to pay a very, very dear price, Rabotai. But not just in the next world, in the supernatural, that everyone can say, listen, did you go there and see it? And all types of stupid statements like that. But they do in this world too. They end up paying a very heavy price in this world too. One of the most shocking stories that I heard from Rav Mizrahi, Sheikh Yeh, is a story that is a public knowledge. Anyone that wants could even look it up. I'm sure it's in the archive somewhere. It's a famous story that happened in Eretz Yisrael, where there was a guy that was a construction worker who had a job in a different city in Israel. And he would go there and it was a stay there for a few days and come back at the end of the week. But as you would have it, one time the job took too long, so he told his wife, listen, I'm just going to stay here for the weekend. What's the point of getting home just to come back here late and so on? You know, so I'm just going to stay here for the weekend. I'll see you next week. And the wife said, okay, no big deal. She hasn't seen him the whole week anyway. She's okay. I mean, it's very normal for men to travel, and especially in the old days, they used to travel for years sometimes. Years. That's actually part of the reason why some men had multiple wives. Permissible. According to the Ketubah, they would ask permission from their original wife to have another wife because they're going to live in a different place for several years. This is no longer allowed in Judaism, but nonetheless, according to the Torah, it's allowed. But in those days, that's because they used to travel literally for several years to make a certain amount of money and then come back home. So today, it's not so common. People usually don't travel for many years. Usually, they would travel for, you know, a few weeks maybe, a few months even, but not usually for that long. In this case, it's not even that. He would go to work for a few days and then come back, a few days and come back. In this case, there was a delay. So he says, you know what? I'll just see you. You know, I'll skip this return because it's already too late. And I'll come back next week. Okay, no big deal. It's an old marriage already. They've been together for 20 years. Okay, so, you know, I miss him. He misses me. I love you. I love you. Okay, hello. Well, Rabotai Karim, boredom leads to sin. Boredom leads to sin. Boredom leads to sin. And the guy was sitting in his hotel after work, tired. But all of a sudden, he's in a hotel. He's got some energy. What am I going to do? Where am I going to go? I don't want to go anywhere. Well, nightclub? I don't go to nightclubs. TV? Oh, nah, I'm not going to watch TV. It's boring. What's it? What am I going to do? What am I going to do? So he sees that the hotel has a phone book, and he decides to open the phone book, and he says, oh, maybe I'll order something for myself, some food, some this, some that. And of course, he sees the escort service, Hashem Yishmor V'Yatzil, all the prostitutes. They also have advertisements in the phone book, in a newspaper, and in magazines, and even sometimes the paperwork of the actual hotel. So he sees one of those, and the Yetzirah takes over him, and he, doot, 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 doot. Okay, I'll get one. No one's ever going to know. No one's ever going to see. What's the big deal? It's only one time. I'm here. I'm a guy. It's not going to, I'm not, I don't love her. It's just a thing. What's the big deal? And that's what he does. And he calls and he dials. And they said, okay, we'll have somebody by you in the next 45 minutes. Hashem Yishmor V'Yatzil Rabotai. He's about to commit an Isur Karet. He's about to commit an Isur Karet, but he doesn't even think twice about this. Doesn't think twice about it. He's figuring, I'm a guy. My wife is not going to be hurt by it because she'll never find out. It's not like it's going to be a relationship or anything. One time thing. HaKadosh Baruch Hu says, a person that makes sins, he's a Rasha. But a person that makes sins in hiding is cursed. Cursed is such a person. And the second that he put that phone down, he starts to get excited. He starts to start thinking things, expecting to see somebody special. And he does. He does see somebody special because as soon as the door gets knocked and he opens the door and he sees his 18-year-old daughter that's supposed to be in school, that's supposed to become a doctor, she decided to also become an escort. and he didn't know about it. And he starts screaming, and she starts screaming, and they're both screaming, and he gets a heart attack, and he dies on the spot. He was making a sin in hiding. She was making a sin in hiding. And they both ended up living a cursed life. This, Rabotai, is not an individual story. There are other stories like this. There are stories like this that unfortunately happen more than once. And in some cases, you'll see that it even gets worse. It even gets worse. I'm not going to give you the details. Hashem Yishmo. It even gets worse than this. It even gets worse than this. Rabotai Yekarim, the Gaon Mivina tells us, in the name of David HaMelech, who says in the name of HaKadosh Baruch Hu, Kol Kvoda Bat Melech Pnima, all of the honor of a woman is inside. And the Midrash Tanchuma Parashat Vayishlach says, extensive commentary on how much reward a woman gets for being modest. Where if she behaves in accordance to the highest level of modesty, including the fact that she, it's not just a clothing, but also the way she communicates, the way she speaks, she will become fit to marry a Kohen Gadol and bear sons that would become Kohanim Gadolim. And not only that, Rabotai, because you could say, yeah, but there is no Kohen Gadol. And even my kids can't become Kohanim Gadolim. So I guess this reward for this mitzvah is gone. This is just the beginning. The Midrash says she provides atonement for our family just like the Mizbeach. The Beit HaMikdash, we had an altar. We had a Mizbeach. People made sins. They brought a sacrifice. $20,000, $30,000, $40,000 cow or bull. They brought it there to pay for a sin. One sin. Another guy's sin. Another guy's sin. The Midrash says a modest woman becomes the atonement for the entire family like the Mizbeach. The whole family gets rewarded because the mother covers her hair with the mitpachat. The whole family gets blessed with parnasah because the mother is modest. The whole family gets rewarded with good spouses and kids and everything you can because the mother is modest. The whole family gets rewarded because the mother becomes a mizbeach, an altar for the whole family. Why? That's why the Gemara says a woman in the Torah is called bait. What's bait? Bait is house. That's the woman. That's the wife. She's the house. Wherever she is, that's where your bait is. That's where your real home is. It's not in New York. It's not in Florida. It's not in Israel. No, no. It's wherever your wife is. That's your bait. Without a good woman, there is no good life. There is no good life. In fact, Rabotai, there are many things in the Torah that would shock a person. Some things are pretty obvious. For example, a bad wife is a tragedy that some people are falling into. And everyone knows the damage of a bad wife or a bad husband. But is this something that you can foretell? Gemara says yes. The Gemara says yes. Gemara Masechet Kiddushin, page 78, says, Rabba bar Rav Ada says in the name of Rav, Kol anoseh isha leshum mamon, whoever marries a genealogically blemished woman for the sake of her money will have children who are unworthy, who also have blemishes. You marry a woman because of money? You're going to get punished. By who? By Hashem. Further, he says, and some say, in the name of Rav Sala, in the name of Rav Nuna, Kol anoseh isha she'ena hogenet, hogenet lo, Eliyahu kofto ve'akadosh baruch hu, rotz'o. Whoever marries a woman that is not fit for him, Eliyahu Navi ties him to the whipping post, and HaKadosh Baruch Hu himself whips him. What does it mean? You marry a woman because of her looks. You marry a woman because of her money. You marry a woman because of the wrong reason. You didn't marry a woman because she has good midot. You didn't marry a woman because she could be a good wife. No, you're marrying her because you want arm candy. You can rest assured, HaKadosh Baruch Hu will whip you. We'll give you hardship. We'll give you damages. A lot of problems. You have a long list of problems as long as you're with that person. Many times people are surprised that they were dating somebody, in a relationship with somebody, boyfriend, girlfriend with somebody for 5, 6, 7 years, but finally they got married. 3 months later, they want to divorce each other. Like, I don't understand, we were together like married couple for 5 years, but 3 months after we got married, we can't stand each other. Of course, it's no question. You're married for the wrong reason. You got married the wrong way. You acted the wrong way. The whole thing is full of tum'ah. The whole thing is full of tum'ah. When you are doing it without any connection to Hashem, you're doing things against Hashem. The Satan was giving you power. The Satan was giving you support to stay together 50 years unmarried. Stay together 100 years without going to the mikveh and being nida. And every second it's isul karet and so on. The second you wanted to involve Hashem into it, that's it. It's all gone. Unless you're both going to do serious tshuva, all of the curses that you've earned yourself over those 5 years start showing up on day one. Why? Because the whole thing was wrong from day one. That's why it's never a good idea to delay shiduchim, to delay, you know, once you've decided, that's it, she's the one for me, he's the one for me, that's it. Right away, as soon as possible, the sooner the better, a month or less. A month or less, the minimum amount of time to get married. Don't waste any time. Why? Yetzirah is looking. Yetzirah is looking. This, Rabotai, is very simple. But now, where is the source? Where is the source of Kol Kvoda Bat Melech? The Gemara in Masechet Yevamot, page 77a, says that the statement Kol Kvoda Bat Melech Pnima, that the very honor of the princess is within, is where and we also have another statement, which is a the angel saying to Avraham Avinu, V'yomu elav ayeh Sarah ishtecha, that the angel said to Avraham Avinu, where is Sarah your wife? And he said, Na'oil, in the tent. And this signified that that she was the princess. She is the princess. She was in the tent. She was reserved. She's not hanging out with the guys having beers. So the Chachamim say, where do we learn this? He says, we learn this, number one, from Avraham Avinu and his wife Sarah, you know, more Sarah than Avraham in this particular case, because Sarah was the modest one. Not that Avraham wasn't modest, but obviously it's more particular to Sarah here. But we also have another source. What's the other source? We have a halacha in the Torah. What's the halacha? That the Ammonites and the Moabites, you're not allowed to marry them. Even if they convert, not allowed to marry them. Never allowed to be part of Am Yisrael. They could learn every shul Torah in the world, not allowed to marry them. They're never allowed to be part of Am Yisrael. But the Ammonites, and not the Moabites, the Ammonites, the male, but not the female. The Moabites, the males, but not the females. Them you're allowed to accept their conversion, and they're allowed to become part of Am Yisrael. Why? Says, because the Torah tells us, these Ammonites and Moabites, when we were in a desert and we needed some water, we came to them, and they did not come to help us. They did not want to give us any water. And HaKadosh Baruch Hu says, people that are ungrateful, people that are stingy, I never want them to be part of my people. And he literally cursed them permanently. Okay, fine. We know why the whole nation, the Ammonites and the Moabites, why they're cursed and they can never become part of the Jewish people. Even the Egyptians can eventually become part of the Jewish people. Even Nebuchadnezzar was actually a Jew. You know, his mother was a convert that married, or grandmother was a convert that married Shlomo HaMelech, even though he hated Judaism and everything else. So you see that there are certain people in the world that can become Jews, can be accepted. Even Amalek. Amalek is technically, you're not supposed to accept him into Klal Yisrael, but Haman's descendants converted to Judaism and then they're becoming big rabbis in Bnei Brak, the Gemara says. So we accept him eventually, but the Moabites and the Ammonites never accept him, not even 10 generations later. But the women, yes. Why? Because when we went to them for water and basic necessities in the desert, they didn't want to give it to us. Okay, fine. Gemara says, fine. Okay, but why are you allowed to convert the wives? Because Ruth was a Moabite. That's what the whole Gemara is about. Ruth was a Moabite. How come she was allowed to marry Boaz? She's the grandmother of David HaMelech. Mashiach comes from Ruth, who's a Moabite. How come you're allowed to marry a Moabite? A female Moabite. How come you're allowed to marry a female Ammonite? Why? If the husbands are so cursed, surely the women should be cursed. And the Gemara says, no. Kol kvoda bat melech pnima. What? Kol kvoda bat melech pnima? Says, yeah, the women, the Moabites, they didn't go, they did not go to the women of Israel, because the honor of a woman is inside. So Rabbi Ephraim brings a clarification. In a sefer, Achtov L'Yisrael, Siman Yud Gimel, Chelek Dalit, talks about modesty and different issues, and then he talks about this Gemara. He says that there are many people that misunderstand this Gemara. Why? They think that we learn that we're allowed to marry the Moabite women if they convert to Judaism because they were not part of this whole crime against Am Yisrael of not giving water in a desert because they stayed home because women are reserved. Women that are reserved stay inside the tent. He says, that's how a lot of people understand it, but it's not so. That's not the case. You think that we're going to, you know, the Moabite women are going to be compared by our sages to Sarai Menu? Because we're using two sources that women are reserved, that are staying in a tent. So you're saying, one example is Sarai Menu. The other example is the Moabites women. Cannot be. Obviously, there's a clarification here. Why? Because there's no way that the Moabite women can be considered as modest women. Number one, we see what happened when the Midianite women came to them and said, come on, let's go make the Jewish men sin. And they all came to us in Parashat Balak. And they made the Jewish men sin, and 24,000 of us got murdered. You know, Hashem destroyed 24,000. Kadosh Baruch Hu brought a plague, 24,000 of us. Worse, you know, people that started going with the Moabites, with the Midianites. So Kadosh Baruch Hu killed all of them because part of it was also idolatry. Until Pinchas ben Elazar ben Aaron HaKohen killed the major sinner Zimri ben Salu, who was with the princess of the Goyot, Cosby. He killed them both and in a miraculous way, and that's how the decree ended. But the point being here, we see that the Moabite women weren't exactly modest. They not only left their tent, they left their tent specifically to go make sins. So how can you say, number one, that they're modest? Number two, not only modest, but so reserved that you're comparing them to Sarai Menu? Obviously, this is not what the Gemara is saying. So what is really the Gemara saying? He says, no. No, we're not saying that the Moabites and the Ammonite women were modest. No, it's that when Am Yisrael was in a desert and they camped out and they needed to get the water, they went to the Moabites. They went to the Moabites. It says, whose job is it to go get water, to go get drinks, to go get everything? It was the men's job to go get it. It's the men's job to go get it. That's the men's job. So the men go deal with the men. Yeah, but the women have to take care of themselves also. They have to go shopping. And that's what the Gemara is teaching. No, when a woman has kavod, but Israel, even for the necessities of water, she didn't leave her tent. Even for the necessities of water. Meaning that we learn the whole issue of modesty that's relevant to this verse, not from the Moabite women, from the Jewish women, where the Jewish women, Am Yisrael, did not leave the tents to go meet with the Moabite women and ask them for water, and therefore the Moabite women had nothing to do with it. They had nothing to do with not giving water because none of the Jewish women came to them to ask for water. So we can't punish them for not giving us water when we didn't ask them for any water. The only people that were asked for water were the husbands, were asked by the Jewish men. And since the husbands, the Moabite husbands and the Ammonite husbands, rejected the request of the Jewish men, they get punished. I mean, it's very likely that the women of the Moabites would have also rejected our request for water, but they didn't. Why? Didn't have the opportunity to reject it. We can't punish somebody for a sin they didn't commit. And therefore, they are allowed to convert to Judaism. But as far as the modesty aspect of it, what we learned from the modesty, no. The modesty in Am Yisrael, the Bnot Yisrael was so reserved, so holy, that even for the necessity of water, they wouldn't leave the tent. They wouldn't go out there. They wouldn't go waltzing around looking for a third wig for her daughter's bat mitzvah. They weren't doing things like that. Why? They knew. Kol kvoda bat melech pnima. Kol kvoda bat melech pnima. That, by the way, is also mentioned by the Maal Shah, and it's also quoted here in Achtov L'Yisrael by Rabbi Ephraim in the third volume. If anyone wants to read it, it's on the website. You can download it for free. Now, here we see, Rabotai Karim, the significance of modesty. Significance of modesty. Another great example is in the Gemara Masechet Yoma, page 47a. Gives an example of a special woman named Kimchit. Kimchit, the Gemara says, she was a very modest woman. And because of her modesty, she merited to see all seven of her sons become Kohanim Gdolim. Not just Kohanim, Kohanim Gdolim. Because her modesty was like, she was wearing gold, where she was like the purity, the holiness that she had. She was so modest, it's as if she's wearing gold at all times. Her sons merited spiritual gold. Her sons merited to walk around with gold as the Kohanim Gdolim. Always have gold on them. Now, as far as the logistics of how you could have seven sons that are Kohanim Gdolim, because in reality, if they were all righteous, then how could all of them be a Kohanim Gdolim? On a short, simple explanation is that they weren't all the first position. The Kohen Gadol has a replacement in case he has keri. He has seed comes out of his mouth, out of his member on the night of Yom Kippur, on the eve of Yom Kippur. If he has keri, then he can't be the Kohen Gadol the next day. So he always has to have a replacement, and the replacement kept being one of our other sons. And Hashem would make it that the Kohen Gadol would have keri, and he would be replaced by his own brother the next day. And this happened literally for all seven sons. So now, how did this woman merit to have seven children that are all Kohanim Gdolim? Imagine having seven Rav Ovadias, seven Aaron HaKohen, seven Rabbi Yosef Karo, seven Chafetz Chaims. It's unbelievable. Even the Chachamim were enamored by this, and they came to her, Miss Kimchit, please tell us, how did you merit to have such amazing sons, all tzaddikim, all amazing people, Kohanim Gdolim? She says in the Gemara, all of my days that I lived, even the walls in my house never saw my hair. Where when I put the kisui rosh on my head, now sometimes you have to change it. I always had covered everything, but sometimes I have to go and take it off or do something to fix it, right? I slept with it. I was with it at all times. What about when you have to change it, replace it, things like that? It says even when I covered my, I had to change it. I put some type of sheet on top of me, and I would change it under my sheet. So my walls never saw my hair. Chachamim, unimpressed. Why unimpressed? He said, listen, kol hakavod, amazing that you're so modest, but many women have covered their hair with the mitpachat and not showing their hair to the extent where they're doing similar to you. They're changing their kisui rosh under some type of sheet, and they don't have seven kids that are kohanim gdolim. There has to be something else. Has to be something else. But then, if you go to the Yerushalmi, the Gemara Yerushalmi, Masechet Yoma, Perek Aleph, Alacha Aleph, 1-1. Has the same story again with Kimchit. But in here, they give us the filler. What's going on? She says, all of my life, she says actually different. She says, may I be cursed. May I be cursed if at any moment in my life, the walls have ever seen a single hair on my head or even the inside of my jacket. And here the Chachamim say, ah, okay, now I understand. What's the difference? What's the difference? First of all, she puts everything on a line. I'm not just saying this. She says, may I be cursed if I'm telling you that. I'm not trying to show off, oh yeah, I read the whole Tehillim today. No, I'm telling you, may I be cursed if I'm seeing a single word that's not true. Number one. Number two, same thing, cover the hair with mitpachat, Baruch Hashem. But it's not just covering the hair with the mitpachat. It was completely modest. Even my clothes, I was always modest that the walls never saw the inside of my jacket. Meaning, not just the kisui rosh, because sometimes you can see kisui rosh, but you almost prefer that there shouldn't even be a rosh. This person shouldn't be there because they're so immodest. What's an example? Rav Ephraim told me a story that he heard directly from Rav Moshe Levi, Alav Shalom. Rav Moshe Levi was a tzaddik, kadosh. And he says that his wife, the Rabbanit, one day, she went to, there was a kosher beach for women in Tzanz, in Netanya. Kila Tzanz, the Hasidim over there, they have a section, just women. But there is women. There's male lifeguards. So of course, even if there wasn't male lifeguards, in the kosher beach, you're not going to see, at least you're not supposed to see, any women walking around like the goyot or the immodest walking around with underwear. Or they call that a different type of bathing suit. No, they still walk around with a very big dress of some kind. And, they can go in the water, but they have clothes on. They don't walk around like the swimmer. They walk around modest, but even though they go to the beach. So especially since there's male lifeguards many times. So one time the Rabbanit went to the beach and she came back shocked, distraught, didn't know what to do with herself. And Rav Moshe Levi says, Rabbanit, what happened? Please tell me. She says, I don't know how to handle it. I don't know what to do. What happened? She says, you don't understand. We are in a beach. Beautiful. It's a nice day out. There's water, Kadosh Baruch Hu's creation, everyone's kosher. And then I see one woman, that so-called religious woman, dressed like a zona, dressed like one of these women that walks around with nothing on. And she is standing next to the lifeguard laughing with him as she's practically naked. And then all of a sudden she starts fixing her kisui rosh. She starts fixing her mitpachat. I run up to her, I says, you're fixing your mitpachat? You're talking to a strange man while you're naked? This is what you're worried about, your mitpachat? Sometimes people are that stupid. Rabotai. This is not that old of a story. I even heard the same story with somebody else that also in Eretz Yisrael. Another woman in a French community. Similar story. Where they'll walk around with practically nothing on, but they have mitpachat on. They think they're religious. Rabotai Yekarim, people have no concept of what it means to be modest. How many brachot come with it, and how many klalot come with it, if a person is not modest? But when a person has modesty, they have everything, including, and most importantly, they have shalom bayit. How come you see all the chachamim stay with their wives forever? Not just stay with their wives out of convenience, but stay in love with their wives. Very famous story about Rav Kanievsky. There's countless stories about him, and there's countless stories about his Rabbanit, Batsheva Aleha Shalom. She was an extraordinary tzaddikah that Rav Kanievsky Shichye said, her blessings are bigger than mine. The blessings of his Rabbanit, Aleha Shalom, says they came true. Whatever she blessed came true. It's unbelievable how much this woman did in a single lifetime, how many people she helped, amazing how many things. Now, the Rabbanit Batsheva was a big tzaddikah, and she was a very, very busy woman, because they would constantly ask her to come, speak to a certain person, do certain chesed, help certain people. She was very, very busy. She had some driver that she would take her to the different places and go. So every night, she would get together with her husband, Rav Kanievsky, and she would tell him the schedule that she has for the following day. And he would tell her, no, why don't you cancel that one? You don't really need to go there. Why don't you cancel that one? And what are all these? What is she going shopping for shoes? She's going to the mall. She's going to watch a movie. What's she doing? She's going to do chesed. She's going to do mitzvot. So no, maybe you cannot do this. Maybe you cannot do this. He's trying to tell him, don't go do it. Why? No, I need to do what you would tell him. And she would like tell him, no, but this is chesed I have to do. This is chesed I have to do. Or maybe not. Maybe, why? Don't be gone so long. So now, one of the people heard this one time. And he says, why does Rav Kanievsky, who studies more Torah in a single day than probably we're going to study in a lifetime, why does Rav Kanievsky care if his wife is going to be gone for 1 hour or 2 hours or 5 hours? He's studying Torah all day. All day studying Torah. He wakes up, studies Torah. Torah is just sleep. There's no time to sleep. How much Torah? What does he care if she's home, she's not home? One of the people from the house says, you don't know. He says, Rav Kanievsky says, Rav Kanievsky, Baruch Hashem, he's in Ad 120, he's in his 90s. We're talking about, this is not that long ago, it was maybe 10 years ago. He's in his 80s. He says, Rav Kanievsky says, when the Rabbanit is not home, I don't have yeshuva dat. I don't have focus. I can't think. When my Rabbanit, 80 years old, and she's not home, I can't think. I can read. I can't think, though. I can't think. I can't understand. So I'm trying to cut it close. Cut less time out of the house. Less chesed. Less. Why? I need you home so I can study. I have some people tell me, listen, Rabbi, I think I'm going to be the next Rabbi Akiva. Why? My wife told me she wants me to go 25 years, not just 24. 25 years to the kollel, don't come back. I said, no, that doesn't mean you're going to be the next Rabbi Akiva. He says, why not? He says, because your wife is doing it because she can't stand you. That's why. She's telling you to go for 25 years so she doesn't have to see you anymore. That's not Rabbi Akiva. Or sometimes the woman would tell me, listen, Rabbi, I'm ready to be Rachel. I'm ready to send my husband to a kollel, nice, 25. You know what? 26 years even. You know, Rabbi Akiva did 24. Let's do 26 just for good. You know, that's Shem Hashem, 26. Young woman, it's not a mitzvah to send your husband to kollel for 26 years if you're doing it because you can't stand him. That's not a mitzvah. To send your husband to a kollel because you can't stand him and you think that, maybe I'll get two mitzvot. One, he'll learn Torah and he'll go to my merit. And number two, I'll get a mitzvah of not getting angry because I can't stand the guy. That's not a mitzvah. You are married because you need to get along. You are married because you need to find a way to love each other. You are married because you have to build a life together. You have to build a life together. You have to work together. Yeah, but she says this and he says this. Okay, so stop saying it. You have to talk. You have to say all those things that you say that make her mad, that make him mad. You have to buy all those things that make him mad, that make her mad. You have to go to all those places that make him mad, that make her mad. You have to do it. Stop being annoying and she'll love you. Stop being a nuisance and he'll love you. Start thinking about helping each other instead of milking each other for whatever you can get. Start thinking about helping each other instead of using each other. No, I'm not going to do it because you didn't do it for me. You are making multiple sins when you do things like that. If you don't do something because he didn't do something, you are making a sin from the Torah of taking revenge. Some women and some men will have a whole book of sins just coming from their marriage because they don't know how to be married. They know how to be business people. She has a bank account, he has a bank account. She has a job, he has a job. She has an income, he has an income, and nobody knows anything. All they know about is once in a while they sleep in the same bed. Rabotai Karim, there's no bigger tragedy than a marriage like that. Rabbi Akiva loved Rachel. Rabbi Akiva, his love of his life was Rachel. Love of his life was Rachel. The love of his life was Rachel, and the love of her life was Rabbi Akiva. Before he ever went to Kollel for 25 years. The Chachamim say that they were so poor. Rabbi Akiva and Rachel were so poor. He already was a widow. And he had a kid. Some people say he even had multiple kids that he brought to this young woman as his new wife. Multiple kids, and they're taking care of these kids. But they're so poor, they live in a barn. The only thing in that barn is straw. That's it. Nothing else. Only straw. And the straw would get into Rachel's kisui rosh, into her hair. And every day, Rabbi Akiva would make her feel better by taking the straw out of her hair and give her compliments. And I love you, and I care about you, and don't worry, things are going to get fine. But one day, she got a little extra sad because She used to be a queen, the daughter of Kalba Savua, multi-billionaire. Now she's sleeping in a barn. She got a little sad. HaKadosh Baruch Hu sent them Eliyahu Anavi. He sent Rabbi Akiva and his wife. Before Rabbi Akiva became Rabbi Akiva, he was just Akiva. Just Akiva. He sends him Eliyahu Anavi. Eliyahu Anavi, dressed up as a poor man, saying to them, please, please, can you help me? Can you help me? What? What do you need? We just had a baby and we don't have anything to have the baby sleep on. Maybe you have some straw that we can rest the baby on. Quickly, Rabbi Akiva and his wife Rachel got the straw together. Here, go, you go. Mazal tov, mazal tov. And as soon as he left, Rabbi Akiva and his wife looked at each other and said, hi, see, Baruch Hashem, we have straw. Some people even have less than us. Rabbi Akiva went to yeshiva for 24 years, thinking about his wife all day, all night, and getting strength because he knows that she loves him and she's waiting for him. But she is the one that wants him there. And his wife, Rachel, is suffering dearly that our dear husband, that she loves more than anything in the world, is not next to her. But she loves him even more because he's doing her will. Because as much as she loves him, she loves Hashem and his Torah. And she misses Rabbi Akiva day and night. And he misses his wife day and night. But they're both getting strength because of the love they have for each other. And that's what made them both the greatest human beings. Not that you just send your husband to La La Land and hopefully maybe he doesn't come back, or he does come back, or at least maybe an insurance check come back. No, Habibi. You have to live with each other and you have to learn how to love each other. And you have to work with each other. But that's never going to happen if you walk around as public property, where everyone is allowed to look at you as if you just came out of the shower. As everyone is allowed to look at you and quickly imagine every single thing under the sun just by simply looking at you. Why? You have no honor, you have no kavod, because you've become public property. This, Rabotai, is one of the most extraordinary things. Now, when it comes to some people going to say, listen, but maybe it's, if I was more modest, I wouldn't have the job that I have, or I wouldn't fit in with the society that I have, or it's more expensive, or it's this, or it's that. Gaumi Vilna answers that too. He says, the amount of money that a person needs to spend in order to avoid a sin, the Rama says in Shulchan Aruch, Orach Chaim, 656, 1. He should spend every single penny that he has just to avoid sinning. One of the negative commandments, like lighting fire on Shabbat, or idolatry, or things of that nature. There are different mitzvot. There is 365 negative commandments, 248 positive. Some of the examples are of the negative commandments. Usually they start with don't do this, don't do that. So mitzvah number one of negative commandment is that a person shouldn't consider the thought that there's another God. Another one is not to make an idol. Or not to have any false God, not to believe your rabbi is God, not to believe Yoshke is God, not to make any images or for decoration of some type of idolatry. Can't draw God or anything like that. Don't bow to any false God. Don't worship any false God or any type of service. You can't go to a church under any condition. Don't offer one son to Molech, which is a form of idolatry. Some even say it's a one of the things they would do with wasting seed, connecting to wasting seed. And a lot of different things that are negative commandments. Now, each one of these also includes don't take interest, meaning that if you're going to lose all of your money by leaving the cash advance business, it's a mitzvah. Mitzvah. Why? It's better to lose all your money than to charge interest of another Jew. Better to lose all your money than steal money and be dishonest with a non-Jew. That's what the Shulchan Aruch says. Now, also it says, don't be a missionary. Specifically, mitzvah number 16 and 15. Don't act as a missionary, persuading Jews to worship false gods like Yoshke, Jesus, or the other false gods that are out there. Don't act as a missionary to persuade people to worship false gods, but also into causing them to sin. It's mitzvah number 15 and 16. Not allowed to show affection to a mesit, anyone that entices other people to sin. You're not allowed to show him any affection. You're not allowed to befriend them. It's one of the mitzvot in the Torah. You're not allowed to even save him if they're dying. If they're going to be killed, executed, not allowed to save them. It's one of the mitzvot in the Torah. Now, also, not allowed to, mitzvah number 320. Not allowed to light fire on Shabbat, not allowed to work on Shabbat, 321, 322. Not to inflict punishment on Shabbat, to travel beyond the boundaries on Shabbat, which driving on Shabbat to the Beit Knesset, violates all of these mitzvot, because not only is someone driving on Shabbat, which is fire, but also they're leaving the boundary, going from public to private. So that's also one of the isul in the Torah. So the point being is, there's a lot of different things in the Torah. Now, all of these negative commandments, the Shulchan Aruch says, if you have to spend every single dollar that you have, meaning forfeit it, is the better word, forfeit all of your money, in order not to transgress these things, then that's what you have to do. That's the mitzvah. Give up all your money rather than drive on Shabbat. Give up all your money rather than be a missionary, be an idol worshiper, support a missionary, give up all your money, everything, instead of doing that, lose everything, instead of make any of those sins. So, to be someone that causes other people to sin, to be a missionary, is a horrible thing, so much so that the Rambam says, to do tshuva from causing people to sin is very difficult, almost impossible, but not impossible, if the person was doing it on purpose. Now, when a woman walks around immodest, she's becoming a machtiya rabim. She causes the public to sin. Meaning that on one end, she is being a missionary practically. She's a machtiya rabim. She's causing people to sin and so on. Now, if she says, listen, If I don't walk around immodest, I'll lose my job on the network, I'll lose my job at the company, and so on and so forth. Exactly. You'll lose your job, and that's the mitzvah required in the Torah, for you to lose everything if necessary in order not to walk around immodest, in order to not to make these sins. If that's what you're going to do, that's the answer. You'll have to lose everything in order to not make that sin. That's the answer. Now, and a person thinks that, what's going to happen if I lose all my money? The Gaon Mivilna answers it already. He says, don't worry about money. Why? Ayad Hashem tiktzal. He brings a verse from the book of Numbers, chapter 11, verse 23. He says, saying, is there a limit to what Hashem can provide? He provides food to the huge animals and even to the lice. He's not going to provide you food. Now, if you look at the teachings of the sages, but you only look at part of them, you'll be confused. Why? On one end, there's about a half a dozen or so places that the Torah mentions, the Gemara mentions the issues of Parnassah and how it's all decreed on Rosh Hashanah. One of the places you have in Masechet Psachim, page 118a, where the Gemara says, sustenance to a person, for Hashem to give sustenance to a person, is more difficult, not that Hashem has difficulty, but apparently the merits of a person and all different calculations that go into it, is more difficult than to bring the Mashiach. The individual parnasa, sustenance, to give a person, to give her, to give him, is more difficult to decide and to do, if you will, than to even bring Mashiach. It's more difficult, the Gemara says, than childbirth. It's more difficult than splitting the ocean. Meaning that the issues of parnasah, of sustenance, and how much money people are going to make, and so on, is one of the most, if not the most difficult thing in the world. But yet, the Gemara in Masechet Beitzah, page 16b, 16a, and Masechet Rosh Hashanah in 16b, says that HaKadosh Baruch Hu decides the parnasa of a person, how much money they're going to make, how much money she's going to make, on Rosh Hashanah. On Rosh Hashanah, he decides, you're going to make 100,000. You're going to make 30,000. You're going to make 30 million. You're going to make 500,000. You're going to make negative 1.2 million. You're going to make XYZ. Everybody decided on Rosh Hashanah. Decided on Rosh Hashanah. But this decision also includes the losses. Gemara Bava Batra, page 10, says, on Rosh Hashanah, Hashem decides not just the income, but also losses. Not just how much you'll lose, not just how much you'll lose, but also how we'll lose certain things. How certain things are the possibilities. But there's one wild card. One wild card. What's the wild card? The money that he or she spends on the Torah. That's not included. What does it mean it's not included? Any amount of money that you spend in order to sanctify Shabbat, getting yourself nicer candelabra for your candles, nicer dishes for your Shabbat table, nicer napkins, a nicer chandelier even, for the sake of Shabbat, if it's really for Shabbat, Hashem pays extra on top of the income. Any amount of money that you spend on the mitzvot like Hanukkah, like the Sukkot, like Rosh Hashanah, like anything else that's connected to Judaism, Sfarim, the Tzedakah, the Kiruv, all those things that you spend money on, HaKadosh Baruch Hu says, no, that's not part of the income. I already decide you're going to make $100,000, $500,000, $1 million, $50 million, $30 million, $2, $4. I decided that. But all of that money that you're deciding to give in staka, That's not part of it. I'm going to give you extra with that money. What does it mean, extra? So the Gemara in Bava Batra says, HaKadosh Baruch Hu decides to use that sometimes as the losses. Sometimes I'll give you this money extra where you made $100,000 and you spent $20,000 on mitzvot. HaKadosh Baruch Hu decides, oh, there was no losses that was decreed to you and you spent $20,000 on mitzvot. Therefore, I'll give you $20,000 bonus that you'll get from some place that you didn't expect. And now instead of making a typical $100,000 that you were expecting, you actually made $120,000, some type of inheritance, an insurance policy, some type of bonus, whatever it is. You finish off, bottom line is, with an extra 20%, which you ended up spending in stock already. But Hashem gave it to you. Hashem gave it to you. Meaning that all of your mitzvot, in essence, Hashem paid for them. And you're still going to get a full reward for them. But sometimes, HaKadosh Baruch Hu sees, oh, you were decreed to make $1 million, but you also decreed to lose 500,000. So in reality, you're only supposed to net 500,000, right? But you gave 500,000. You gave $500,000 in staka to help build the next Be'ezot Hashem Yeshiva. You decided to help do kiruv, help Am Yisrael do tshuva, for kolel, for tamidei chachamim, for so on. Ah, so I'll use that staka as the losses. I'll use that stock as the losses, meaning that you'll end up netting still $1 million somehow. How? Kadosh Baruch Hu runs the world. There's no limitation. Is there a limitation to Hashem? So here we see two extraordinary things. Two extraordinary things. But what's the connection? One, don't ever think you're going to lose by doing mitzvot. Don't think that just because you're going to become more modest, you're going to lose more. You're going to lose out on that. Don't think that because your wife is more modest, you're going to lose on that. It's the opposite. Why? Because as we learned, all of the blessings of the house come from the wife's modesty. All of the blessings, again, all of the blessings that are in the house come from the wife's modesty. Because if she's modest, you'll have shlom bayit. If you have shlom bayit, Ish, Isha, Zachu, the Mishnah says, Ish, Isha, Zachu, Shechina Beneim. When there's Shlom Bayit, the Shechina comes, perfects everything that's broken. The Shechina comes when there's Shlom Bayit. Shechina comes when there's Shlom Bayit. Parnasa, the wife. Wife is not modest, Parnasa goes in the garbage. Husband is not modest, he wastes seed and things like that, goes in the garbage. Why would the husband waste seed? If the wife is not modest, for sure he's wasting seed. For sure. Why? Because she looks like a putzah, so he's okay with looking at other putzot also. When the wife is modest, the husband starts appreciating her. The husband starts distinguishing her from all of the zevel that's out there. And he only allows his eyes to look at his wife. He only allows his eyes to look at his wife. But this, Rabotai, all starts with the wife. It all starts with the wife. The wife promotes for the husband to learn Torah, to do mitzvot. She's going to have a good husband. She's going to have good kids. She's going to have good parnasa. She's going to have everything. If she doesn't, she could lose everything. But sometimes it looks like they're winning. Why? Because you'll see a woman and a man, both immodest, both immoral, both everything. And they look like they have money. They have a house, or 5 houses, or 50 houses, and businesses and billions, and they're on Forbes 500, and so on. It's all an illusion. It's all an illusion that HaKadosh Baruch Hu says, Meshalem el sonav el panav la'avido. HaKadosh Baruch Hu says at the end of Parashat Vayetchanan, I pay my haters cash to their face to destroy them. There are some people that cause so many people to sin because of their immodesty and their immorality and their injustice and all the things that they do wrong. Kadosh Baruch Hu says, I've had it with these people. I'm going to give them all of the reward they're entitled to for the few good things that they did in order to destroy them. So it looks like they're winning and that's why they have a big house. It looks like they're winning and that's why they have so much encouragement by society. It looks like they're winning because they're even popular. But they will end up being just like Korach from this week's parasha. Korach was the richest man of the land. Korach was the most popular, had 250 of the biggest rabbis in the world, aside from Moshe Rabbeinu and Aaron HaKohen. All of the other rabbis supported Korach. And the ground swallowed up all of them in the end. With all of the money and all of the reputation and all of the likes, the ground swallowed up all of them. Kadosh Baruch Hu says, it looks a certain way, but looks can be deceiving. Don't be deceived by people that look like they're doing good when they're doing bad. Look at the people that are doing good and know for sure they have good. Even when the good looks bad to you, you just don't have the full picture. Bezot Hashem, each and every single one of us will take this as the fire needed to encourage ourselves to become more modest, whether men or women, to become more modest with our eyes, with our clothing, with our mouth, with our behavior, to encourage the people around us to also watch this and get the encouragement to become more modest in order to have Hashem protect us from all of the evil and the difficult around us, whether it's Hamas and it's the lefty liberals and the Zionists, or it's all types of filth of society, immorality, divorce, heresy. There's just so much garbage out there in the world. Let's do our best to become the pure vessels that Hashem wants us to be. The pure vessels that Hashem wants us to be. And whether Jew or Gentile, you can become a pure vessel. You can become the best version of you by being modest. You start there and you build more. You start there and you can build more on that good foundation. But when there is no modesty, there's no holy Torah. When there's modesty, then you can have Torah. Be'ezrat Hashem, we will build and build and build more Torah in the world through the foundation of our Torah, which begins with modesty. Baruch Adonai le'olam. Amen ve'amen.
Shalom, hi everyone. I'm making a short message for the all the people that ask me all the time if they have money coming in and they want to help with Kiru, but they also want to help the poor people that we usually do during the holidays, but also during the year. They always ask me, is there something going on? And the truth is, there's always something going on. I always tell you during the lectures of different stories that we deal with, whether it's to help somebody come up with money for a surgery, or to help a poor family have food for Shabbat, or to help pay for tuition for someone that simply doesn't have it. And the stories go on and on and on and on. And here in a moment, you're going to see something that just happened in the last couple of days. A family that's so poor in Eretz Yisrael that did not have money to buy simply normal mattresses. They were sleeping on something the equivalent of metal. The only thing this reminds me of is the concentration camps of Shem Shmo. And these stories come across our desk on a regular basis. And after verification, when we send our team members to go and see and make sure that everything is legitimate, we try to do our best to help. And there's just not enough time in a day to make a campaign for every single cause. So what we do is we simply give, and we trust that Hashem will give us to help people, because there's just not enough time. And sometimes time is very sensitive, so it takes time to verify things. But also, it's just one of those things where you really can't wait for people to decide whether they want to help this poor person or not. You know, if there's a need, we're there. And Bezot Hashem will continue to be there. So for any of you that is contemplating what to do with that maaseh, with that 10% that you give, that you need to give as a Jew and also as a non-Jew, for the sake of Torah, whether to give it just to Kiruv, or to give it to help people do tshuva, or to give it to help poor people and how to mix it, bottom line is, our organization does it all. And we do it on a regular basis, and there's simply not enough, because there's so many people that need help. It breaks your heart. And you'll see that in this video, our team member, it breaks your heart, our team member starts crying. That's how hard some of these situations are. And we try to publicize a lot of different videos without embarrassing anyone and showing faces, to show people that their money is going to good places, to help people not only do tshuva, not only publicize the Torah, publicize Hashem's name and His glory, but also to help people survive in this difficult world. So if you want to help us, you want to join us, you want to be a partner with us, Be'ezrat Hashem is very, very happy to be a partner with you. And we look forward to hearing more and more good news, so we can tell you that you are part of another big miracle that happened to someone in Palestine. Call to B'chal V'Avslacha.
אנשים יקרים, אני באתי פה לבית של משפחה נזקקת. האמא הושפזה בבית חולים עם כאבים מאוד חזקים בגב. הבאתי לה עכשיו סל מזון לשבת. חשכו עיניי, אני בא לי לבכות, תראו על איזה מזרון היא יושנת. כל הברזלים בחוץ, תראו, על זה היא יושנת, מזה היא קיבלה דלקת שלא עוברת לה. תראו, זה המזרונים שהם יושנים אליהם. אני חייבת את העזרה שלכם, אני פשוט ישבתי על המיטה, כל הברזלים תקועים לה בגב. תראו מה זה, אני פשוט נוגעת בברזל. על מה אמא יושנת? יושנת על ברזלים? בגלל זה כואב לה הגב? כן? עכשיו אנחנו מביאים לה מזרונים חדשים, ונשים לה על המיטה. תודה רבה על ארגון בעזרת השם ולרב ירון, שדאג לפני שבת למשפחה נזקקת, למזרונים חדשים. הם ישנו המשפחה על מזרונים קרועים עם ברזלים בחוץ. ארגון בעזרת השם, אין עליכם בעולם.